Many people have compared this program to a very loud MRI. I can see that.
On the air everywhere, this is New England Broadcasting.
Welcome to the Ron Van Dam Show. Hold on tight. Things can get a bit weird, if you like that sort of thing.
You hungry? Want a sandwich?
Whatever.
Never mind. Good morning.
Good morning. Good afternoon. Good evening. Good night. It's the Ron Van Dam Show.
That's true. Yeah, he's right.
Back, relax, grab a cup of coffee, a cup of tea, whatever your liquid libation may be in the morning, and join us as we take a look at the world around us. As much as it's a pleasure to be with you, the pleasure is actually all yours. And now, here's your host, Ron Van Dam.
Thank you very much. Welcome to the program. We've got an interesting show for you today, a little bit different. I have an extended interview with an attorney, David Hadas, who's a very intelligent man, very interesting to speak to. And we're going to talk about some of the things that are going on in the country as far as legal aspects are concerned. But more specifically, most of us have jobs. Well, most of you have jobs. And you're performing in a workplace and a private company. And there are various things that can happen or not happen. And it's kind of interesting. I think this interview will spark you to think in directions that are out of the box, like what if this happened to me kind of thing. So that'll be interesting. That's coming up rather shortly in the program because it is an extended interview. I've spoken on this program before about my opinion on jury duty. I get called, it seems like every week. I live in Massachusetts, and they can call you for jury duty every 3 years, and they do, for me. Some of my friends, and I use that with air quotes, some of my friends have never been called for jury duty, or maybe once in their long, productive lives. Me, for some reason, every 3 years, and I don't quite get that, and I complain about it, but it falls on deaf ears because they can call me every 3 years. I do not like jury duty. I'm one of those people that find it to be intrusive. I know that by law and by citizenship to this country, I'm being offered a chance for me to participate in our judicial system. However, I don't want to do it. I don't like it for many reasons, basically because I don't care for people very much. And when people do wrong things, in my estimation, I like to chastise them accordingly. I like to chastise them accordingly, even if they don't do anything wrong. I'm not good on human being interaction. And I don't like this phrase jury pool. I don't like sitting amongst like other people, and then being talked to. I don't like the over, abundance of strictness in a courtroom, where the judge walks into the chambers and everybody has to stand up and kiss the ring. And it's just like, I don't do things like that. I don't stand up when people come into rooms. I don't care who they are. I'm not into that stuff. I'm also very close to people that could possibly put me in jail for no reason whatsoever. So you say the wrong thing, you do the wrong thing, they shackle you, the next thing you know, you're in a maximum security prison because you didn't stand up when the judge walked into the chambers. And by the way, it's a room, it's not a chamber. So I just, it's not for me. I'm too rambunctious. I also, because I don't like people, I don't like sitting amongst them in a situation where I can't leave. What if I have to pee? Am I going to raise my hand every like a half hour and go, I got to pee? No. I just can't. And to be honest with you, if somebody commits some type of crime, and they say to me, Ron, what do you think? I would basically respond by saying, what the hell do I care? Well, I didn't do it. I don't know these people. Like, why are you asking an opinion on something that I had nothing to do with? And if I weren't here, I wouldn't even know what happened. Why are you putting this negative energy into my spiritual positive body? I am not a good candidate for jury duty. I'm really not. I'm not good at it. So don't do it. But I go. I go when I'm called because it is a matter of civic duty. And I sit there and I go through it. But through the whole thing, in my mind, I'm conjuring all these scenarios. Like, what if all of a sudden I stood up and ripped my shirt off and say, I'm out of here. Freedom to the Jews. I don't know. I don't know what I would do. I just don't know what I would do. I don't know. So here's the bottom line. Why do we have to have this I call you for jury duty thing when most of the people who are called for jury duty try as best they can to get out of it? Why go through all this time and effort? Why not, like our military, have an all-volunteer jury pool? There are people who actually enjoy this, and they can be very impartial. They know what it is to be a juror, and they conduct themselves professionally. Everybody is interviewed before they get on a jury anyway, so what's the difference? Why waste your time with people that don't want to be there? And if they are accepted into a jury pool and they don't want to be there, that can be harmful. Why not choose people that have the time, that don't mind being there, that really are able to judge things impartially, like little mini judges? Why not a volunteer jury pool? I know, just like the military, if our country were in some type of horrible situation, people could be drafted as they were during the Vietnam War. A lot of them didn't like that, and a lot of them didn't want to be there. Same situation. Now we have a volunteer military. These people want to be there. They want to perform. They want to do their best for their country. Why not extend this onto the local and district level for jury pools? Ron, you're very smart. You make a lot of sense. I know I do. I've been trying to tell you that for the longest time. Okay, let's move on. So we're going to speak to an attorney today. This is what I do, kids. This is what I do. This is what I do on a daily basis. I'm known as the grumpy guy. I'm never satisfied with anything. I'm always complaining about everything. And I'm known as grumpy, but when you get to know me, I am just the sweetest, most wonderful person you'll ever meet.
Yes, of course, you could have a podcast show host who's congenial and conversational and talks to you like you're both on the same level and discussing the issues of the day. But come on, isn't having a grumpy old bastard who hates just about friggin' everything way better? This is the Ron Van Dam Show.
There you go. The Ron Van Dam Show can be heard every single weekday. Well over 1,500 episodes. You can binge listen until the day you expire, basically. If you can't sleep at night, pop in one of my shows and get a good night's sleep. We're found on NewEnglandBroadcasting.com. The Podbean Network houses all of our episodes. Again, well over 1,000 of them, and anytime you want to listen to them. We're also on all kinds of other outlets, the Spotify, TuneIn Radio, iTunes, Oh, man, all that other stuff. We're on everything. We're on the Amazon Alexa thing. You lift the lid on your toilet. We're in there. I mean, just we're everywhere. We're just everywhere. And, of course, we're also syndicated to radio stations across the country. So thank you very much, those of you that are bold enough to engage in this ridiculous scenario. Let me introduce some of the people that help us with the program, as I do this every once in a while. John Shanahan is one of our writers. He does the comedy commercials, the comedy bumps, the comedy stuff, comedy productions. John Shanahan, ladies and gentlemen, give him a hand. Thank you very much. Jason Shaw produces and performs and writes this music that you hear in the background right now for this program. Thank you so much to Mr. Jason Shaw. Nicole Reed, she's the British babe at the top of the show, and she's also our guest relations producer, books many of the interviews that you hear on this program. Thank you, Nicole. The lovely and talented Julie does a little bit of our announcing at the beginning of the program. Thank you to you, Julie. And thank you to you who have made this show great through the years. Some of you having been with me for nearly three decades. Seriously, Ron? Can you get a life? I know. Three decades. I'm serious. I know. Ouch. Interesting thing is, I'm only 23 years old. How does he pull that off? Math doesn't work here. 30 years and you're only 23? That doesn't work for me. Maybe I'm a little older than 23 by a few months. I'm so old. I was around when storks used to deliver babies. Remember that? Yeah, used to drop them from the air in their beaks. I was around. I was around when Jesus was leading the Jews through the desert. I was the one Jew that said, I don't like the sand in my feet. I'm not going. David Hadas joins us now. He's an attorney, and he's involved in a very interesting case, and we'll speak to him now. How are you doing there, David?
Good morning, Ron. I'm good. How are you?
Good. Pleasure to be with you here. You know, many people get into situations and they don't know whether it's time to contact an attorney or not, but here's a situation that apparently you're involved with a Methuen woman, as I understand it, who sought you out for a lawsuit.
That's right.
And apparently she was with a company. Can I mention the company's name?
Yeah, sure.
It was a Sodexo, which is quite a large company. And she apparently was fired for what she felt was not a good reason and shouldn't have been fired. Can you tell me the story involved with her?
Yeah, sure. The woman's name is Bernadette Coughlin. She worked, as you mentioned, for this large international food services company called Sodexo. Yeah. Over the past year or so, with marijuana being declared legal in Massachusetts, right, she would occasionally, in the evening at home, smoke a little pot.
Right.
And her employer drug tested her several days after she fell at work in a kitchen, just slipped on the floor, you know,
right,
just something that could happen to anybody.
Yes, it has.
They apparently have a policy where if you are in some workplace accident, no matter how minor, that they're going to test you and see what's potentially in your system.
Right.
Came back positive for marijuana. I want to be 100% clear here. She was not impaired on the job at all. If you smoke pot, it's going to be in your system for several weeks, and could come up positive on a drug test.
Right.
And once the test came back positive, despite the fact that she's a lovely woman who was a great employee, had good reviews, great reviews, everyone liked her very much, they fired her.
Right.
And so we have brought a case. It's currently pending in arbitration to challenge this conduct by the employer, which I and many other people who've heard the story think was terribly unfair.
Now, had you mentioned that she was smoking marijuana at home, or where this accident occurred? Was that in her home or at the workplace?
The accident was at work.
Okay.
She's a food services manager in a hospital.
Right.
She's not employed by the hospital.
Right.
She's employed by this company,
right.
Sodexo.
Right, and they place people in situations like that, right.
Yeah, and just a slip and fall in the kitchen.
Right. Oh, so the kitchen was at, okay, I got you. When you said kitchen, I assumed it was an
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, the cafeteria kitchen.
Did she claim any type of injury through the company, or there was no claim placed at all based on her falling?
No, there's no claim of
No disability or anything, right?
No, I mean, there's a normal workers' comp claim when you get injured on the job. She was out for some period of weeks with a cast on her arm.
Okay, all right.
Some compensation
all
for
right.
that.
Okay. Is it the position of the company that their insurance company would require this, or did they say it was a company requirement?
This was purely a company policy.
I see.
There's no need whatsoever for it. It's just something that
okay.
is their internal
right.
policy.
It's interesting to many because there's a huge population that does smoke marijuana, kind of always has, and they do it in their home. With the Massachusetts legalizing it, let me get it clear. It's a state allowance, not a federal allowance. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah. Under federal law, it's still what's called a Schedule I drug,
right.
and it's prohibited.
Yeah.
Not enforced at the federal
right.
level
right.
For the most part. I mean, right. you know, maybe the feds would go after big time
right.
Kingpins and drug dealers
as a way, not users. Right, as a way to get into their searches and things like that. So that's weird. So you can do this in the home. I think you always could in the home, actually. I think that was always the deal. And I'm sure many people don't understand why the company would take that position, but they probably respond, that's company policy and that's the end of it, which leads me to the question, can companies indeed, because they're independent private sources, unless they get some type of federal funding or something like that, can they indeed make up their own rules willy-nilly?
Well, the answer is mostly yes, except that in this case, we argue that they've run afoul of what's called the Privacy Act
yes.
under Massachusetts law.
Ah.
You are protected from unreasonable infringements on your privacy, and that right to privacy has been applied by the courts in many different circumstances. One of which is employer drug testing. So,
yeah.
So you as an employer, you can't just do anything you want.
Right.
You are subject to this law, and if your drug testing of your employees is found to be unnecessary or unreasonable,
uh-huh.
then an employee is going to win that type of lawsuit. In these cases, it's a case-by-case basis, and the courts balance the employer's interest in testing their employees right. against the employees' interest in their privacy, and depending on the circumstances of the case, yeah. one side will win out.
Yeah. You know, what's interesting to me is how you can have a policy like that, give them a drug test, fire them accordingly, and yet never give them a sobriety test, because isn't their point at this company is that, well, we don't want you working in an impeded manner. But wouldn't that be proven by sobriety, such as an alcohol situation, where they give you a sobriety test to see if it's indeed affecting your work?
Yeah, I mean, part of this is the different, it's sort of at the scientific level, certain things that you might ingest, mm-hmm. Such as alcohol,
right?
The next day is gone. It's you get tested, and it's going to come up negative. Whereas marijuana, just because of the how it right. gets stored in your body, several days later, you're still going to get a positive result, even though you're not impaired.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it's not a legal question, but I question why Sodexo would even install that type of policy. Unless they had a reason for it, unless they were just, I don't know, spinning a roulette wheel and saying, how can we exert power in people? I mean, I don't know what their point was.
It's hard to know. My guess is that it's an antiquated policy that's been on their books for years, and stems from, you know, a time right. not too long ago when people thought marijuana was some terrible thing, which attitudes are yeah. rapidly changing about that. Yeah.
Is your client, do you think, looking for, or are you and your client looking for a settlement, or looking, does she actually want her job back? Sometimes when these things happen, you don't want to work in a company that has that kind of atmosphere to begin with, even if they took her back.
You know, Bernadette actually loved her job.
Sure.
She loved the people that she worked with. She would love to go back if that's in the cards. It usually does not happen in these
right.
types of cases.
Right.
She worked with several other Sodexo employees at mm-hmm. this hospital,
mm-hmm.
All of whom support her very much. They, in fact, the young people, they tend to be young people who she managed. These
sure.
are people that would deliver food to patients' rooms. Like, you know, if you've ever been in a hospital,
yeah, right.
you get your meals delivered to
right.
you. So those folks even started a Free Bernie campaign. They made signs and tried to make a lot of noise that they found it terribly unfair that she was terminated.
Interesting.
Yeah. So, but as I said, that usually doesn't happen in these cases. We'll see what happens.
Okay. For those that aren't familiar, you said it was an arbitration. What exactly does that mean?
So a lot of times with larger companies, when you get hired, your first day, you might get a visit from someone at HR, and they're going to have you sign a bunch of papers. And in this case, Bernadette signed a whole bunch of papers,
which was
an arbitration agreement saying that if there's any dispute between the company and her, instead of filing a lawsuit in court,
really?
she would file it in arbitration, which is unfortunate, but it's the cards were dealt, so we're gonna move forward with that.
Yeah. You know, there's so many circumstances where people sign long documents, especially when they want a job. They will just sign on the line. They don't take them home and present them to an attorney to say, should I sign this? It just doesn't happen that way. When
right.
you want the job, you sign it and you figure everything's cool. And it seems, I'm not saying it's deceptive, but it kind of rolls into that area if it's not explained point by point, rather than just shoving a piece of paper. And I don't know if that was the case, where it's just signed. And I guess that goes for anything. I mean, any type of large purchase you're making, any type of contract. I mean, there's most of us don't read that line by line.
Well, yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, they, as you said, they shove a bunch of papers in front of you. Very quickly, you barely look at them. And even if you did look at them and considered them, when you're getting a job, it's what we call unequal bargaining position.
Yes.
You're not gonna make a fuss about it. You're
correct.
Just gonna sign and start your job.
Yeah. Well, her working partners at the company must be pretty pissed at this point. So I guess it's caused some type of revelation anyway, which is sometimes just as poignant as not.
It's been eye-opening, I think, for some at her company. Maybe they didn't even realize that this was a policy. Also people who've heard about this case. Who may be working at different companies. Some have asked, well, how do I find out what my company's policy is?
Correct. And that's part of why we're talking today, because people should be aware of A, their rights, and B, what circumstances could arise from things that they didn't even expect. So it's interesting, and good luck to you as far as that's concerned. I wanted to move on to something else that's in the news, and I don't know if you want to comment, but a lot of the conversation now on a national basis has to do with sexual aggression in companies, or experiences one might have had in high school, shall we say. I think you know what I'm referring to.
Right.
It's a confusing situation for the public, because I don't think they understand. There's no legal aspect to this Brett Kavanaugh situation, as far as I can see it. I mean, this is just a discussion of people coming forward on an important national appointment. But legally, as far as you see it, that's not part of this conversation. Is that right?
Yeah, this is, certainly an employee who is sexually harassed in the workplace or where the there's an atmosphere created in the workplace, hostile. There are legal claims that an employee can bring if the employer is complicit in this, doesn't know anything about it, knows about it. That's not the case with Kavanaugh. But if you're an employee in a workplace and there's a hostile work environment, there are claims that you can bring.
Yeah.
Don't wait 35 years.
The reason I bring it up is that this Kavanaugh thing might be giving women, and even men that are harassed or in a compromising situation, such as Dr. Ford was, it might be giving them the message where if you come forward, you're going to be lambasted like Dr. Ford is, whether this happened or not. But it kind of makes, I think, it's even like the priest situation. It kind of makes you think twice about even bringing it up now, because look at what kind of public trouble I can get into. And I think that can be a little damaging. It might shy people away from actually moving forward.
Yeah, every case is different. Circumstances are different. If you're an employee and something like that is happening to you, has happened to you, I guess I would say speak with an attorney.
Yeah.
Lay out the facts and ask for advice as to how best to move forward. And any time you make a claim, the other side is going to push back and scrutinize it. And so it all depends on what evidence there is, what happened.
Going back to the marijuana situation, Is there a message for people that do smoke marijuana, of which I know tons of people who do?
Our friends.
Yeah, exactly. Is there a message that you should be careful, or I mean, what do we learn out of this beyond what Sodexo is doing here in the position they took? But is this something we should all be concerned about? With we're all employed by private industry, many of us are.
Right.
Is this a concern indeed? Do you stop and say to yourself, maybe what do I do here?
That's a good question. I would advise anyone to, number one, figure out what the company's policy is. So that can be a visit to HR, ask those questions, see the actual document, so you know what you're dealing with. Some companies that do drug test for marijuana, they may not necessarily fire you if you're positive.
Right.
So it's good to know the lay of the land. And if it what happened to my client happens to you, maybe you
pursue
have a good lead frame. As a last resort, but you know, it's always good to avoid that if you can.
Right. I mean, I certainly wouldn't go to HR and say I smoke pot. Is that okay here? I mean, I wouldn't do that.
Just ask the question. Don't don't need to volunteer
right,
any information.
Exactly. Or let me just see the HR stuff. Just give me a copy of that. I lost mine. Something like that.
Right,
I don't know. Okay.
Right.
Hey, David, it's been a pleasure speaking to you, and I appreciate it. Maybe we can talk again in the future. This is good conversation, because people should just be sure of what they're doing, certainly in a situation that might be a little gray for some companies, so to speak.
Well, happy to talk anytime, Ron. Thanks for having me on.
You take care. Thank you. Bye-bye.
You as well. Thanks.
Well, there you have it. David, thank you so much. That was wonderful. Makes you think a little bit, you know? And that's what's important here. I'm totally out of time today. I'm going to be back again tomorrow with a brand new show. Until then, you've just been wonderful. I don't know how to repay you, so I'm not going to. But remember this. Have yourselves a wonderful day, and I wish you peace. Oh, man. Oh, God.